Hey, good morning, church. So excited to see you all here this morning and excited to worship with you. This is going to be a wonderful time together. I know that hopefully all of you have been well fed this week, so I'm going to do my best to make sure that you at least keep one eye open during the service. Let's go ahead and pause this morning, and we're going to start with our call to worship, which comes out of Ephesians chapter 1, verses 3 through 5. Blessed be God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. Even as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before him, in love he predestines us for adoption to himself as sons and daughters through Jesus Christ, according to the purpose of his will. Would you join me in a prayer this morning? Heavenly Father, we thank you that you call us your children. What an amazing gift it is that we do not serve a God who is far off or distant, but instead we serve a God who calls us his children and recognizes us and loves us as a heavenly Father. What an amazing gift that is. Lord, I ask that you would help us this morning to turn our gaze and our focus toward you, that this time of worship would be a time where we would just really lift up your name and be excited for the ways in which we have seen you working in the last week. Lord, we just celebrated the holiday of Thanksgiving, and we could spend all of our time just thinking about how thankful we are for your grace, for your forgiveness, for your salvation, and for your love throughout our lifetimes. So, Lord, help us as we work through worship together and be with us as we learn and grow together. We ask this in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and everyone says, amen. Praise God. And so, this is not a stunt or a joke. Unfortunately, my beautiful wife is at home sick. Fun story, she got sick on Wednesday. She rallied for turkey, did Thanksgiving, and on Friday, the whole thing came apart. Bolts fell off everything. So be in prayer for Laura. The good news for you is we're doing video worship. I am not singing. That is not going to happen. We tried to get Nate Webster to do it. Nate bailed. You can get mad at him later. But I want to just remind us, even though worship is on a screen, and it might not be as impactful as it is having the whole praise team do it, our focus is not around a performance. Our focus is around exalting Jesus Christ. Amen? And we are able to do that no matter what, whether the praise team is here or not. And so I would just invite you, as we stand together, let's stand and let's praise God and focus in our worship on him as we walk through the videos together.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In darkest night, you are are close like no other. I've known you as a father, I've known you as a friend, and I have lived in the goodness of God.
Are you past the point of weary? Is your burden weighing heavy? Is it all too much to carry? Let me tell you about my Jesus. Do you feel that empty feeling? The shame's done all it's stealing, and you're desperate for some healing. Let me tell you about my Jesus. Where there ain't no way, rises up from an empty grave. my Jesus. He makes a way where there ain't no way, rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sinner that he can't save. Let me tell you about my Jesus. His love is strong and his grace is free. The good news is I know that he can do for you what he's done for me. Let me tell you about my Jesus. Let my Jesus change your life. Hallelujah. 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 Amen. 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 Hallelujah. 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 Let my Jesus change your life.
I searched the world, but it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise, the treasures that fade, are never enough. Then you came along and put me back together. Desire is now satisfied.
Praise the Lord. And good job. You guys were worshiping amazingly. So give yourselves a pat on the back if your shoulders can make it that far. All right. So let's just run through a couple of announcements. Then I have a couple of guests that I'm going to introduce you to this morning. So the first thing is congratulations, everybody. We had 44 shoeboxes for Samaritan's Purse. So we got those all filed in on Monday. And so that was wonderful. Good job. Cannot wait to see how that goes. Secondly, our children's Christmas program is Sunday, December 6th or December 10th at 6 p.m. Sunday, December 10th at 6 p.m. You're going to want to block out this time and you're going to want to bring tissues because you're going to laugh so hard you'll cry. It's amazing. It is the most organized chaos you'll ever see in your life. And we'll hear the story of Jesus on top of it. Also, can you believe it's December this week? Is this insane or what? The live nativity is this next Sunday, December 3rd, two showings, 6 and 7 p.m. I have a praise report. We have someone to come and behold. We have Mary and Joseph, and I don't know if we have a live Jesus. If we do, we are dedicating him in short order. So if not, we will not put that sort of pressure on anybody. But really excited for that. But here's my ask. Our angel list is a little short, right? The story goes, a whole host of angels come to celebrate Jesus. Right now, we've got a lame quartet. Amen? Cannot happen. We want a heavenly host, not a few people, right? So if you are willing, we would love to have some more angels sign up, and then those angels can also help park cars. You get what I'm saying? This is a multifaceted deal this Sunday. But in all seriousness, I really want to ask that you would pray. Because while this is a lot of work on our end, and sometimes we forget it, what you need to know is that there will be people who have not heard this story. And we need to pray that the Lord will use this in a way to help bring them closer to himself. Amen? And so I ask that you would pray, and also that you would schedule out some time next Sunday evening to help us make this the best possible presentation we can for the gospel and for our community. And so with that, I have a friend that I would like to invite up. I would like to introduce you to our brother Brad Thomas. And Brad is going to come and he's going to share about Gideon's International and how Gideon's can be a blessing to our church family.
Good morning. I know it's been a while since there's been a Gideon speaker in the church, and I want to thank the pastor for giving me a few minutes here this morning. Darla put a gun to her head and she pulled the trigger. She later wrote, her life didn't start out hopeless like that. She was raised by two hardworking, loving parents, but Darla wasn't taken to church. She didn't know anything about God, and she didn't know that she was a sinner who needed a savior. Well, somehow Darla got into her young childish mind that if she drank and took drugs, she could be rich and famous like all the rock stars, and she began to do that at an early age. One day when Darla was in college, there was a Gideon handing out testaments, and Darla received her first copy of God's Word. She said she fully intended just to throw it away, but she put it in a drawer and forgot about it. Eventually, it got to where Darla was consuming $200 worth of drugs every day. Well, one night as she looked in the mirror, she thought about all that shame she'd brought upon herself and her family, and she remembered that gun. This time, she was going to pull the trigger until it fired. Well, she went to the nightstand where she kept the gun. She reached in, but when her hand came out, instead of holding that gun, it was holding that testament she'd put there years earlier. Darla opened it up and began to read it, and Darla gave her life to the Lord. I'd like to thank you for this opportunity to share this testimony this morning. This testimony illustrates that Isaiah 55:11 is true. So shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth, it shall not return unto me void, but it shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the thing whereto I sent it. In behalf of the Gideon's International and the recipients of over 1 million copies of scriptures, that we hand out each week, we'd like to thank you for your past offering, for it may have been your offering that purchased that testament that Darla received. You see, it's through your Gideon offerings that people come to a saving knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. That's the sole purpose of the Gideons, to win others to Christ. Where are these people? Where do the scriptures go? Many go right here in Hancock County. We do a distribution in all the county schools. We piggyback with the LifeWise and also the religious education classes. We also do one in Donnell and Glenwood. We're also in all the motels in the county except for two. We do nursing homes, universities. I'm sure you've seen them in doctors and dentist offices. And also to try and reach maybe some of the kids that were not in schools, we do have a booth at the Hancock County Fair, and we usually give out 800 to 1,000 every year. But I'm happy to say the Gideons are also in 200 countries with the scriptures written in 80 different languages. Who are the Gideons? We are Christian business and professional men, and our sole purpose is to win men, women, boys, and girls to our saving knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. And we do that by personal one-on-one witnessing as God leads us and by sowing God's word. You might be asking, how can you help the Gideons? Well, we have in the basement, we have a memorial Bible rack. And the cards are free, but you can purchase Bibles in memory of a lost friend or loved one. We also have in recognition cards. These are great to give for birthdays, graduations, or any special occasions, and also thinking of you cards. And with Christmas around the corner, you can also help support the Gideons by using Gideon's Christmas cards. So you can go online to the Gideon website and purchase Christmas cards and help spread the word. If time permitted, I could share many testimonies of how God's word changes people's lives, from a janitor at a school distribution who found one in a trash can, and that changed his life. There's also a man who started reading the Bible while he was using the pages of the Bible to roll up his cigarettes in a motel room. And also, there was a man whose life wasn't going very well, and he happened to purchase a used car, and there was a Gideon Place Testament in the glove box. And he happened to start reading that book, and that totally changed his life. And I'm happy to say that he is now an active Gideon in our Hancock County camp. One other testimony I'd like to share is a man I know personally. His name is Dana, and Dana is a part-time farmer, and he's a part-time pastor. And things weren't going too well for Dana. And one night he told his wife that he didn't love her anymore and that he was leaving. And Dana left his wife and his family. Well, one night when Dana was in a motel room, there's a Gideon Place Bible on the table. He went over there, picked it up, and he happened to open it up to the book of Malachi, chapter 2, where God says that marriage is a covenant and that he hates divorce. Dana didn't like what he read. He flipped through the pages. Guess what? There was that same passage. A third time, he flipped through the pages and read that same passage. In anger, he threw the Bible back up on the table. He pulled the covers over his head, and Dana wished that he was dead. Well, that night, God changed Dana's heart, and the next morning, he knew he had to get back to his wife and his family. And I'm happy to say that Dana's wife now have been married over 50 years, and they have a marriage ministry. And an interesting part of Dana's testimony and how God works is that night I told you he read that passage three different places in scriptures. It's only there one time. This morning, I hope each one of you had a chance to pick up a bulletin insert. I hope that if you have the time, you have a chance to look at that and read that. And if the Lord inclines you to, you'd want to support the Gideons financially, you can write a check or a credit card, and in the back of these inserts, there's an envelope where you can send it in to the Gideons. And everything that you give to the Gideons goes 100% for scriptures and scripture distribution. All of the operating costs of the Gideons comes out of our own membership dues. And the picture on the screen up there is probably one of my favorite pictures. It probably best illustrates why I'm a Gideon. I don't know who that young lady is. Maybe someone here does. That picture was taken at the Hancock County Fair, And that young lady was sitting in the grandstands reading that testament that Gideon gave to her at the fair. And I got to thinking, I might have been the Gideon who gave her that testament. But someone's generous gift to the Gideons purchased that testament. Maybe it was you. Maybe it was you. Thank you.
Thank you, Brad.
Thank you, sir. So Brad invited me just a couple months ago to the pastor's dinner for the Gideons. And what I will say is the Gideon ministry is what I would call one of the evangelical arms of the church. They train faithful men and women how to hand out what they call testaments, which is kind of a compilation. And when they hand them out, they teach them how to share God's word, how to evangelize to them. And so it's a really powerful ministry. I was very impressed. And so if you want to know anything more about the Gideons, or maybe that's a skill you would like to grow in, Brad would be your insider trader on that one. See him and make sure that you talk to him about that. So thank you so much, sir. Now, I'd like to invite all the kids forward. I'd like to invite Miss Judy Schick to come and share the beginning of our Advent devotions with the kiddos.
This is the time for the kids to come up.
Come on down. Can you guys sit down here in front of me? I'm going to sit in this chair. Hi, my name's Judy. It's good to see you this morning. Did you all have a good Thanksgiving? Did you eat turkey? Did you? Okay. I thought maybe you were going to say no ham, but you had a turkey. Did you color any turkeys this week? Maybe, or draw any? No? Okay. Well, it's good to see you. So now that Thanksgiving weekend is almost over, what celebration are you thinking about next? Yeah, Christmas. I knew one of you to remember. Okay, and it's hard to believe. I know, parents, this is for you as well today. As these kiddos, it's hard to believe that this Friday is December 1st. And at church, we talk about December 1st. Can you see these numbers on these little blocks? I know from back there it's difficult, but it's 1 to 25. And we celebrate in the church, we call that Advent, the first four Sundays before Christmas. We think about Advent, which means coming. So we're preparing, and we're excited about the anticipation of celebrating Jesus's birth. And you know, sometimes that gets lost in the hustle and bustle of Christmas. We all have good intentions, right? That we're gonna think about Jesus every day and not think about me and gifts and buying gifts and cookies and baking and all that stuff we love. So we're excited about your anticipation, but we also want you to think about Jesus. So the church family is going to give this little box to each of you, and we have a family name on each box, and it says on one end, Advent blocks. And right there it says, the King is coming. So we want to think about King Jesus' birth. And so, parents, this is really easy, so I'm going to explain a little bit how we're going to do it. When you open the box, you'll see this little book, and it's filled with wonderful stories, and you get to read one each day from December 1 through 25. It even gives you a diagram, so it's all easy stuff. And you want to lay out these blocks somewhere in your house so that everybody can see them. And so on day one, you let someone in the family hold the star. So while mom or dad or one of the kids reads the story, they get to hold the star. And then the next day, on December 2nd, which will be Saturday, you put the star and you just keep moving the star until you get closer and closer to Christmas. So we want to channel your anticipation and your excitement about Christmas a little bit more towards thinking about Jesus. And so the exciting thing is the stories begin with why. Why did Jesus come, and why do we think about that? So the very first story is called How It All Began, and it's the story of Adam and Eve. And it's just a short little story to read. And then there's a neat poem at the end of every story. So I'm just going to share this with you, and it'll kind of give you an idea so you can help remind moms and dads, let's sit down and read our story tonight, okay? Or maybe before you go to school in the morning. Who knows what's the best time for you? Okay, here's the little poem. But outside the garden, God seemed far away. So Adam and Eve began to hope and to pray. God, will you bring us back one day? God, will you come back and stay? So that's going to start making us think more and more about Jesus' coming and his coming back. Okay? So next week, we're going to talk about the first Sunday of Advent, and I'll be back for the next four Sundays. We'll come up with something fun to think about Jesus, okay? So for those of you who can read, can you find your last name on one of those boxes? Let's see if we can find and take these back to your parents. Here's the Taylor family and the Webster family and the Broadmans. Didn't get theirs yet. Gonzalez, do you want to take that to mom and dad?
Dismissed to junior church.
And Frost have one here, and Kizabers and Kendricks.
Thank you so much, Judy.
You're welcome. I'll come get those this week when we decorate. Thank you.
You're welcome. All righty. So this morning, we are going to bow our heads, and we're going to do kind of a group prayer together. So will you bow your heads with me as we go to the Lord in prayer? Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you for the gift of the Gideons and for believers who are wanting to share your word with everyone they meet. So Lord, we are blessed by that. Lord, we're thankful for all of the kiddos. And we ask that this Advent season would be a time where the whole family would draw close to you. And Lord, we are so thankful for a lot of things as we come off the Thanksgiving holiday. Brothers and sisters, this is your time in the next few moments. I just want you to praise God for something. If you have a confession, go ahead and confess it to the Lord. And also, if you have any concerns this morning, go ahead and surrender them to the Lord. We're just going to spend a few moments in meditation. Lord Jesus, we just want to say thank you again. We could spend all morning just saying thank you because you have been so gracious. For anyone who has confessed anything, I want to remind you the Bible says that if you're faithful to confess your sins, Jesus is faithful to forgive you. And so I just want to remind you, you are a forgiven people this morning. And finally, God, any concerns that are brought into the house this morning, anything that's weighing us down, Lord, would you help us to trust you and to hand those things fully over to you? And now, Lord, would you be with us as we learn more from your word together, as we get to see the reward of faithfulness for the saints. God, I just pray that this would be a time where we are uplifted in our spirits. Would you be with me as the teacher and all of us as the students as we learn and grow together? We ask this in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And everyone says, Amen. We're going to start things off this morning a little bit unconventional. I need everybody to hold up one hand, right? I'm not making you take an oath or any of those things, but I did want to talk to you about your car insurance. Anyway, all right. So with the other free hand, I want you to hold it out, and I want you to bring it together with this hand at a rapid pace until it makes a clap, right? One, two, three, go. That's called a self high five because y'all are sick and I'm not touching you and you're not touching anybody else, all right? But the reason you're getting a high five this morning is because The Bible verse we're about to read is hands down the most preached Bible verse out of the book of Revelation, right? This section, Revelation 21, has been preached at every pulpit, at every church that I've ever known. But you're one of the only churches that I know who did the hard work of walking through all of the unfun stuff to get to the fun stuff. Amen? You did good. So that high five was for you sticking it out. Because this week we are dealing with the second part of the two-part question. Last week we dealt with Revelation chapter 20 in a section called the Great White Throne Judgment. In my opinion, this is the most challenging section of the book of Revelation, and here's why. There are a bunch of ways that people interpret the book of Revelation. Some people believe in an early rapture where Christians are taken up. Some people don't really think that a physical rapture is going to happen. There are a lot of different interpretations on how the events of the book of Revelation are going to play out. But do you know the one thing that every Orthodox church believes regardless? Every church, regardless of denomination, if they are a Bible-believing church, all of them believe in a literal judgment. There's not one denomination that doesn't think Revelation 20 is going to be a real thing. And so, as we talked about last week, like the question that still burns in my heart and hopefully your heart is, how do we help people to know that they need their name in the Lamb's Book of Life? And I hope that question never leaves your heart. But this week, we're going to answer the question, what is the reward for having your name in the Lamb's Book of Life? Have you ever thought about that? What is the payout, the benefit, if you will, of having your name in that place? And Revelation 21 helps to answer that question. So if you have your Bibles, let's go ahead and open it to Revelation 21, and I'm going to start with the first 8 verses. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, preparing as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, for the former things have passed away." And he who was seated on the throne said, "Behold, I am making all things new." Also he said, "Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true." And he said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give from the spring of the water of life without payment. To the one who conquers will have this heritage, and I will be his God, and he will be my son/daughter. But as for the cowardly, the faithless, the detestable, as for the murderers, the sexually immoral, sorcerers, idolaters, and all liars, their portion will be in the lake that burns with fire and sulfur, which is the second death." Amen. So, this morning we're going to talk about the newness of it. I was telling some friends, one of my family members bought a Tesla, and they let me drive the Tesla brand new. That is a weird thing. Everybody loves new things. Amen? And we get to see here that the end goal for God is to make a new heaven and a new earth. This is the pinnacle of what's going to happen here. And this is wonderful. Because really what we want to think about here in the text is we want to be reminded of the very first chapter of our Bible, which is Genesis chapter 1, right? God creates all things in 6 days. On the seventh day, he marveled. In Genesis chapter 2, we see that humanity is given authority over the earth and everything is perfect. I don't know one person who reads Genesis 1 and 2 and thinks, "I wouldn't like to be there." Anybody here look at Eden and go, "Nah, that's not for me. I like chaos," right? let me just tell you how good it is, right? Did you guys know that in Eden, work was actually fun and you look forward to it? One of the curses of sin is that the ground will fight back against you. Thistles weren't a thing in Eden, right? No, nobody's getting poked or stabbed or fought or any of those things. Work was actually a blessing. We will work in heaven. You know that, right? Like, I had one person say to me, I don't want to go to heaven. I'll be bored. I'll just be floating on a cloud all day. And it was like, that's not how this works, right? Get off your cloud and get down here, right? But we're going to enjoy it. Ladies, did you know that in Eden, childbirth was completely painless, right? It was smooth sailing, right? The good news is there'll be no more kids in heaven, so we don't even have to worry about that. But in Eden, childbirth was completely painless. It was a blessing. I don't know what it was. You have a cup of coffee and you're at home by noon. I don't know. But a part of the curse of sin is that childbearing becomes painful, right? This section of Scripture is the reinstitution of Eden. God has remade everything. He has reset everything, but there's one key difference, which is, where is the serpent? Where is the dirty liar that got us into this in the first place? Well, this time we know where he's at. He is locked up in his fire prison, and he has no stake, which means that none of this is going to be reset again. Sin is never going to be a thing ever again. And from here, this new Eden, we see that the new Jerusalem is prepared like a bride for her groom. And this imagery is used all throughout the New Testament. Jesus refers often to himself as the groom and as the church as the bride, right? And this makes me so happy because as a pastor, I get one of the most fun seats in the house because I get to stand next to doting grooms as they get to see their bride for the first time, right? I will tell you, a man never looks more happy or stupid than the first time. Like, you've never seen cheekbones get that high up before, and you're like, push those down a little bit. You're going to strain a cheek muscle, right? Than when they see their bride for the first time, right? The imagery here is Jesus is coming to collect us as church, and he's never going to let us go ever again. You're done. We are home. We are home. And I love this image. And it also brings about the reminder of the fullness of the new covenant, which we're going to talk about here in a little bit. So from this new creation, this new earth, the bride that is now ready, we come to probably my favorite section. I have been waiting to preach on this for a long time, which is the reminder that there will be no more tears, right? The first thing we see here is that there will be no more barrier between God and humanity. One of the things you have to remember is because we have sin in us, God cannot get too close. There's a really funky story in the Old Testament where the Ark of the Covenant, which is the place where God's presence rests, it's the most holy artifact in all of the world, is stolen, and the Israelites find it, and they're bringing it back home, and, well, the Ark looks like it's going to tip off of the carrying case. And so one of the Levites, one of the temple workers, says, I've got to stop it, and goes to push the ark back stable. You know what happens to him? He vaporizes, like something out of Star Wars, right? Just gone. You know what that story's about? You can't get too close to God's holiness. His presence is too powerful. Another interesting story is, in the Jerusalem temple, the most holy day in the Jewish calendar is called Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement. It's the day in which the high priest does sacrifices to forgive the sins of all of Israel. And one of the rituals is the priest gets to go into this place called the Holy of Holies, right? The most holy place in all of the world where God's presence is close to earth. And one of the rumors about how this goes is before the priest goes in, they tie a rope around him because if the Lord smites him while he's in there, nobody else can go in and get him. So they can at least drag him back out and put somebody else. Could you imagine being round two on that, being the bad, like being in the bullpen? It's like, all right, how'd that go? You don't want to know. Get in there, chief. Like, okay, all right. Here's why. Because God's perfect presence near our sinful presence isn't capable or possible. But in the new covenant, in Jeremiah 31, what we see is the fulfillment here that God and humanity will be face to face and there'll be no more barriers. You'll actually be able to see God and be near God because the serpent is put away and there'll be no more sin. It's going to be this amazing moment. I don't know if you came tonight to worship last Sunday, but I always love it. There was definitely a tangible presence. Like you could feel the Spirit in the room, right? And the irony of it is, that is so minute. Like it was a wonderful experience, but that was just a small sliver of what it's like to be in God's presence. That's like an eyedropper, one drop out of an eyedropper. In heaven, we will be face to face with the Lord, and there will be no barrier. And it's going to be the most amazing thing you've ever experienced, I promise you. From there, we get to see the most read scripture in Revelation. I will wipe away their tears from their eyes. There will be no more corruption or pain or death. I want to pause here, though, because this scripture means more to me now working through this book. I'm going to give you a little quiz, and the good news is that there is no lasting repercussions for the quiz if you fail. But let's see how you do. The book of Revelation only mentions one group of Christians specifically, and they mention them a lot. Does anybody know what group of Christians is mentioned? The martyrs. Does it make sense now, knowing that the people that are held to the highest esteem are the people who suffered the most on this earth, and the Lord says, I will meet you, and I will personally wipe away the tears from your eyes. Just to remind you of the setting, the Apostle John is writing the book of Revelation on the island of Patmos. Patmos is an exile island that Rome uses to get rid of difficult people that they can't arrest. They leave you on Patmos so you die of starvation or exposure. And church history tells us John never makes it off of Patmos. He's dying here. This is his last place. And to hear from the Lord that his faithfulness and service, even giving up his own life to serve, the Lord is going to be the first one there, and he is going to personally make sure that those tears are wiped away. Doesn't that have more impact? But the cool thing is, I don't believe that is just here. I believe that this is a promise for all believers. Every week, right? We didn't do it this week because we had a lot going on, but every week we have this time in our service where we do praises and concerns, right? And I just want to be blunt, and I'm not judging, but the truth of the matter is that if I had to give you the last 8 years of praises and concerns, I'll let you guess which jar you think would be bigger. Hands down, no question, the concern side of it would outweigh the praises by a lot. And that's no judgment. That's actually an acknowledgement that suffering exists, and we don't want to belittle that or make that minute. We have to acknowledge that. If I never hear the word cancer in my life ever again, I would be a happy man. Amen? Can you imagine being at a church service where there's no room for concerns because, quite frankly, there's nothing to be concerned about? Like the angel comes up and says, all right, everybody, we're going to do our praises, and, well, our praises. I guess there's no other need to do anything else because there's no other problems. There's nobody who's been diagnosed with anything. No bad things have happened. Quite frankly, everything is the best it's ever been. And, well, the good news is tomorrow is going to be way better than today, right? That's what we're talking about here. That's the kind of worship that we get to look forward to. There will be no more tears. There will be no need to cry, because in God's house, everything is perfect. Amen? And that's what you and I get to look forward to. The church service with only praises and only praises and only praises. And now we want to get to the answer to the question, what is your reward for endurance? And we see here that John is told, like, I like how in this narrative, the angel stops and tells John to, hey, write this down.